Good morning, dear students. Welcome to another session of digital communication. So in a previous session, we discussed regarding some of the aspects related to digital communication. So before proceeding into the actual discussion, so we discussed what is meant by sampling, what is meant by digital communication, what is meant by analog communication, how it is classified, what happens. So those are things we have discussed. So moving further with a few other basics, so which is required in coming fourth sessions. So we'll be discussing regarding those. So next, some of the introductions are to some standard signals. So already you have come across these things in your signals and systems part. So it will be an overview kind of thing wherein we'll be discussing these things, and then we'll move further with the first module part, in which we'll be discussing regarding Hilbert transform. So the first this one is the unit step function. So we'll be representing it in the continuous waveforms. So it is identified by u of t, wherein its value is equal to 1 when the value of t is greater or equal to 0, and it is 0 otherwise, or when t is less than 0. So this is how it is represented in its waveform. This is how it is represented. So when it is greater than 0, that is from this point, u of t is equal to 1, and when it is on the other side, it is 0. So next, another important function which comes is the impulse function, which is in many cases you might have seen that what is the impulse response of a system. So we try to identify these things, right? So it is the impulse function, which is denoted by delta t. So it is equal to what? It is equal to 1 when t is equal to 0, and it is equal to 0 otherwise. That is, apart from at t equal to 0, it is not having any other value, that is delta t. So what does this indicate? It indicates that the when t is equal to 0, it is equal to 1. It indicates the area under this curve is 1. Area under this curve is 1. So that is one of the important signals what you have to remember when you are going with communication. Then apart from that, you have come across a ramp signal, in which it is denoted by R of t, and it is equal to t when t is greater or equal to 0 and 0 otherwise. So here, what does this imply? If you just see R of t, you just substitute the value of t and see when t is equal to 0, ramp signal value is 0. If it is equal to 0.25, ramp signal value is also equal to 0.25. 0.5, it is also equal to 0.5. When t is equal to 1, R of t is equal to 1, and so on. It will continue up to infinity. And when it is t value is less than 0, ramp signal value is 0. So this is with respect to ramp signal. So unit step, impulse, and ramp signal. So then, apart from this, a few more signals you come across. So in which one of the important functions or one of the important signals you come across is signum function. It is signum function. So in signum function, you can observe here, what happens is signum function is having a value of 1 when t is greater than 0, and it is having a value of minus 1 when t is less than 0. So when it is 0, t is equal to 0, signum function is equal to 0. So it is a kind of discontinuity which is present at t equal to 0. So this is one of the important functions which we have to remember, because in many cases we'll be using this signum function. We'll be using this signum function. So signum function, it is denoted by SGN of t. So wherein when t is greater than 0, that is in this range, signum function value is 1. when t is less than 0, it is equal to minus 1. And when it is actually equal to 0, that is t value is actually equal to 0, at that time signum function is not having any represent. That is, it is not, it is having a value of 0. So this is one of the important functions what you have to remember. Then apart from this exponential function, you have come across, which is denoted by e raised to alpha. So whether based on the value of alpha, you can define it, whether it is decaying exponential function or raising exponential function, or whether it is a constant. So here we can have three cases in which if alpha is equal to 0, then what happens is e raised to 0, it will be e raised to 0, which is equal to 1. So in this case, it will be a straight line. That is with the value of 1. For all the values of t, it will be having a value of equal to 1. Now, if alpha is less than 0, so it turns out to be e raised to, that is alpha is negative. Alpha is less than 0, alpha is negative. For example, e raised to minus t, e raised to minus 2t. So here alpha value is minus 1 and minus 2 respectively. So here we get the exponentially decaying function as time period, as the time keeps on increasing, as we keep on increasing the t value, what happens is the x of t value, that is e raised to alpha t value, keeps on decreasing, that is decaying. So that is what is represented over here. So it will be an exponentially decaying function when alpha is less than 0. Now, if alpha is greater than 0, that is when it is a positive value. In this case, what happens is as t value keeps on increasing, the x of t keeps on rising, and it will be rising in the exponential form. So we have three conditions with respect to exponential function. Then coming down to another function, rectangular. So this function is of usefulness when we are dealing with communication. So we'll be coming across this one, and we'll be coming across signum function majority of the times. And since we are dealing with Hilbert transform, right, we'll be coming across all these signals. So that is the purpose why we are discussing these things. So here next we have a rectangular function, which is actually represented as x of t is equal to a into rectangle of r by t. So here what does this is actually t by t. You can specify it as t by t. Okay. So here this is giving you the amplitude of this function, amplitude of this overall function, and this will help us identify what is the duration of that rectangular function or the signal. So here if you just observe, this is how it is represented in waveform, wherein the time, the duration of one rectangular pulse should be equal to t. So here when we just observe what happens is, we'll be having from minus t by 2 to plus t by 2. So in this range, if I just estimate, this will be equal to overall t. That is the time period, duration of this pulse will be equal to t. And its amplitude is around a. So if I just take an example, 4 times rectangular function of, say, t by 6. So what happens is, you'll be having it from, so this duration should be equal to t. In this case, t is equal to 6. So it should be equal to 6. So it will be minus 3 to plus 3. And this is the amplitude value. This is the amplitude value. So next function which we come across is the triangular function. So the name itself tells that it should be triangular in its representation. So if I want to have a triangular signal, so this is the equation which we utilize. So wherein A gives you the amplitude and 1 minus magnitude of T divided by T. So in this case, again, if you just observe this period, if I just observe, that is this duration, it will be equal to 2 times t. So it will be from minus 0 to t, it will be a ramp function which is shifted version, which is shifted towards left. And this one is also a ramp function, but it is moving in the other direction. So you have to make the adjustments. When you combine both, you will be getting the overall triangular function. So this is in simple form. This is how it is represented. Okay. So an example is shown over here, where A is the amplitude of this ramp function and T is given over here. So here, if you just observe, what is the duration of this triangular function? It is equal to 10. So when I substitute the value of T, right, I'll be able to plot this triangular function. So sinusoidal, all of you have used it many a times. So in this, we have A times cos of omega naught plus minus phi, where this is just the phase representation. If there is any phase shift, we can represent over there. Either it will be in cosine form, or you can use the sine form. So based on whether it is sine or cosine, so if sine, when I substitute this part equal to 0, so sine of 0 will be 0. It will be starting at this point. But in cos, if I substitute this part equal to 0, cos of 0 is how much? It is so when we go with the sine, right? When we go with sine, the plot will be from 0. And when we go with cosine, right, depending on the amplitude. So if it is equal to 1, then it will be starting with 1 over here, because cos of 0 is equal to 1. And depending on the amplitude, it will be altering. If it is A, it will be equal to A. And if it is here, it is equal to A, then it will be maximum value will be A. So that is what will be happening over here. And sine of 90 is 1 and cos of 90 is 0. So what happens is these two are like inverted versions of each other. That is 90 degrees out of phase with respect to each other. So the sinusoidal signals you have come across many a times. Then we have another important function, which is sinc function. We have the sinc function. So in sinc function, what happens is the function is represented. It is actually sinc. The sinc function is represented in this form, wherein you have sine pi into t divided by pi into t. But it is not always in this form. It is also represented in this form, that is sine x y x. Sinc function is also termed as interpolation function. It is also termed as sampling function. It is also termed as sampling function. So here it is also sometimes termed as interpolation function. But majority of the times you will be coming across this sinc function. So when we, I think you might have come across the Fourier transform of rectangular pulse. Fourier transform of rectangular pulse is a sinc function. And sinc function's Fourier transform is equal to the rectangular function. So what does this imply is, it implies that rectangular function in one domain is equivalent to sinc function in the other domain. So that is what it implies. So because, and these things will be coming across regularly. So rectangular function and sinc function, so these things will be referring every now and then in communication. So here, so when you substitute the t value, right, in this equation, that is t is equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on, when you continue, right, you will be able to get this waveform. So this is how it goes around. So next one, what we have to discuss is some of the Fourier transforms. So we'll not be solving these things, but we have to, because already you have gone through this in mathematics and then signals and systems. So we'll be just having a recollection of what all things are present in this Fourier transform. So just a few things, and then we'll look into a table. That table you should remember, so that in coming four sessions we'll be able to refer to them directly and utilize them. So here we have how is the Fourier transform represented? It is x of omega. Sometimes they use even x of f. Okay. So in that case, what we have, omega is equal to 2 pi f. So we should remember that. So that is what we are doing. It is just for simplicity what they represent. So it is x of omega, which is Fourier transform of x of t. X of t is the input signal, which is in the time domain. Now, here it is nothing but when we have a signal in time domain and we apply any of the transforms, say in our case, we are applying Fourier transforms, we get a signal which is in, we get an output which is in frequency domain. So this is a time domain and this is frequency domain. And when we apply inverse, right, inverse Fourier transform, in which we consider the frequency domain representation, we apply inverse transform and then we'll be able to get the time domain representation. So here, how is Fourier transform represented? It is taken as integration from minus infinity to infinity x of t into e raised to minus j omega t, and the integration is with respect to the time, that is time domain. Now, if I want to get back the original signal in the, if I want to get back the signal in the time domain, I have to take the inverse transform of the frequency domain representation. So, in which we'll be having 1 by 2 pi integration of minus infinity to infinity x of omega into e raised to plus j omega t, and the integration is with respect to the frequency domain. Now, why this 1 by 2 pi comes is the output of a Fourier transform is gives you a spectrum which is repeating in nature. So if you remember, if you have a frequency in this form, just for example, I have x of t. And if I take a Fourier transform of this signal, right, what happens is I'll be getting a spectrum which will be repeating in nature. So it will be repeating in nature. So that is that's why what happens is, since it is repeating, it appears as a periodic representation, and we take a period of 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi, and then we estimate the original information. Okay. So that is what is happening in Fourier transform and its inverse representation. Now there are some certain functions what we have to look out for, okay, for which we will be utilizing later also. So here what we have, what is the Fourier transform of the rectangular function? So when I obtain the Fourier transform of this, so this is the representation of the signal, okay, where it is minus 2 by 2 to 2 by 2. Only in this value you have a value where you have an amplitude of 1. So therefore, what happens is the limits change from minus 2 by 2 to plus 2 by 2, and since the value of this one is 1, it will be like 1 into e raised to minus j omega t. So, and when you solve this equation, right, when you solve this integration, you will be getting this final representation. So, you will be getting this equation wherein it will be 2 sine omega t by 2 omega 2 omega 2 by 2 divided by omega. Now, what we have to do is I have only omega part here. And here, if you just see, 2 by 2 is extra. So what I have to do is, I have to divide and multiply this with 2 by 2. So when you do this, what happens is, this part will be sine omega 2 by 2 divided by omega 2 by 2. This 2 gets cancelled. due to which I'll be having only tau sine omega tau by 2 divided by omega tau by 2. So when this is a sinc function. So therefore, what we imply from this, the Fourier transform of a rectangular function is equal to a sinc function. That is, in time domain, if I have a rectangular function, in frequency domain, I'll be getting a sinc function. So that is how it is represented. And when you substitute this omega value, since you're plotting x of omega, right, you put the different values to omega and you try to plot it, we'll be getting this sinc function. You'll be getting the sinc function. Now, what is the Fourier transform of an impulse function? So Fourier transform of impulse function, here it is. So delta impulse has a special property that when you multiply any signal with delta of t, that signal, that is, if you have something like x of t into delta t, so this will be reduced to x of t to t, where t value is 0. So this will be equal to x of 0. So here the same thing applies. So it will be reduced to e raised to 0, which will be equal to 1. So therefore, what you have, using the property, you get to know that impulse function of, a Fourier transform of impulse is 1, which is a constant value. So this is how it is represented. So this is a time domain representation of delta t. Its frequency response, Fourier transform, in that is the frequency representation, is in this form, which is equal to 1. If I take the inverse, what is its value? So inverse, again, here the property of delta omega comes into play. So here we have inverse Fourier transform of delta of omega. So that is, here we can see that delta of omega, here it is 1. In this case, it is 1. So here we can observe that if I have frequency response as delta omega, if I have an impulse in the frequency domain, what is its representation in the time domain? That is what we have to check out. So delta omega is the impulse function in the frequency domain. In time domain, what happens? So for that case, what I have to do, I have to apply inverse Fourier transform. So in this case, what happens? 1 by 2 pi integration minus infinity to infinity delta omega e raised to j plus j omega t d omega. So again, I apply the property of delta omega. So in this case, it will be e raised to j omega t, where you have to consider omega because of this impulse. Omega, that is, it will be having only value at omega equal to 0. So it will be equivalent to e raised to 0, which will be equal to 1. So this part, this integration will be equal to 1. So and 1 into 1 by 2 pi. So wherein I'll be getting 1 by 2 pi. So what is this implying? Delta omega, that is in frequency domain, if I have an impulse, in time domain, I'll be getting 1 by 2 pi. I'll be getting 1 by 2 pi. And if I just take this 2 pi at the other end, so it will be 2 pi into delta omega will give me a response in this. So that is, if x of t is equal to 1, its Fourier transform will be equivalent to 2 pi times delta omega. So what is happening? The area is changing. So delta omega's area will be altered. So it will be unit, but here it will be 2 pi times that value. So that is what is happening in this case. So now what about the shifted version of delta omega minus omega naught? So I have delta omega, so which is actually represented over here. So I have delta omega. Now, if I shift it either to the right or to the left, so it can be seen like this, or if I have it like this. So whether it is omega delta omega minus omega naught or omega plus omega naught. So here what we'll be considering is, we'll consider say omega minus omega naught. That is, we are shifting it towards the right. That is this signal. So that is delta omega minus omega naught. So what it implies? So this implies that, so this particular case, it implies that it is 1 when omega is equal to omega naught, and it is 0 otherwise. It is 0 otherwise. So that is what it implies in this case. So here the inverse Fourier transform of this one is given by this inverse equation, inverse Fourier transform 1 by 2 pi integration from minus infinity to infinity with delta omega minus omega naught into e raised to j omega t d omega. So here again you have to use the property of delta omega. So this one, when we multiply impulse with this, what happens is this will be e raised to j omega t. Whatever value is here, right? That is omega, that is omega minus omega naught should be equal to 0. So here, what does this imply? It will be omega equal to omega naught. So we have to substitute this value over here. So I'll be getting e raised to j omega naught t. I'll be getting e raised to j omega naught t. So once we solve that, I will be getting this one, 1 by 2 pi e raised to j omega naught. So that is this particular value. So we are using the property of the impulse function. That is, when we multiply impulse with any of the signal, so it will be equated accordingly, because impulse is present only at one point. At the other points, it is all zeros. So here we have what, 1 by 2 pi omega naught. So what does this imply? 1 by 2 pi e raised to j omega naught. So this is time domain representation. So this signal's Fourier transform is nothing but shifted version of the impulse, delta omega minus omega naught. If I take this one at the other end, it will be e raised to j omega naught t. Its Fourier transform is equal to 2 pi times the shifted version of the impulse. That is, it is shifted by how much? It is shifted by omega naught. So 2 pi delta times omega minus omega naught. Now, similarly, if this is e raised to minus j omega t, if this is e raised to minus j, here it is plus, if it is minus, so this is what it is like, e raised to j into minus omega naught into t. So here what this should replace this value. So one, it is minus of minus omega naught, which turns out to be plus. So it is 2 pi times delta omega plus omega naught. So that is what is happening in this case. Why we require this one is because we have certain representations, that is cos and sine, which are represented in Euler's equation. So because of that, we require these representations. Because when you're considering modulation, when you're considering communication, right, you come across these things. Say in your analog communication, you had studied regarding the modulation. So in which what you had done, you had taken a message signal m of t and altered the characteristics of the carrier signal. Say this one, when we multiply these two, actually we get the AM signal. So here, when we're doing this, carrier is generally a sine wave. So when we have the sine wave, what is the overall result? So that will be converted into its respective representation, and then you go ahead with the analysis. So that is what you're doing here. So remember, e raised to j omega naught t, its Fourier transform is 2 pi times delta omega minus omega naught, and e raised to minus j omega naught t, its Fourier transform is 2 pi times delta omega plus omega naught. Now, what is the Fourier transform of cosine? So here, what we are doing, here we have cos omega naught t. So this one, we can represent it in Euler's form. So it is, e raised to j omega naught t plus e raised to minus j omega naught t divided by 2. So this is how cos is represented. So now apply, since Fourier transform is linear in its nature, because you have, you are multiplying, it is, you have half into this one plus half into this factor. Those are the properties what we are using directly over here. So what is the Fourier transform of e raised to j omega naught t? Fourier transform of that is 2 pi delta omega minus omega naught. And what is the Fourier transform of e raised to minus j omega naught t? It is 2 pi delta omega plus omega naught. So when 2 pi is common, so it is 2 pi into delta omega minus omega naught plus 2 pi into delta omega plus omega naught. The whole is actually divided by 2. So now if you just observe what we have this representation. So this is the result, that this is the Fourier transform of cos omega naught t. Now 2 is common, so you can just cancel it off, and pi is common. So overall it turns out to be pi into delta omega minus omega naught plus delta omega plus omega naught. So this is what you will be getting. So what does this indicate? So here, this is the impulse, this is one impulse, and this is another impulse. So what does this indicate is, this tells that, say this one if I consider, so it tells that at omega plus omega naught equal to zero, omega plus, when omega plus omega naught is equal to zero, I have a value for delta. So that is delta of omega plus omega naught, it is equal to 1 when omega plus omega naught is equal to 1. So when I solve this, what I get? When omega is equal to minus omega naught. So when omega is equal to minus omega naught, that is at this frequency point, I have one. So here what we have is, this one gives me a impulse value at omega is equal to omega minus omega naught. At this point, I have one impulse. So this one tells me that at omega equal to plus omega naught, I have another impulse. And what is the area under that? It is area under this one is pi, and area under this one is pi. So that is what this amplitude implies. So this is this is the Fourier transform of the cosine. Similarly, Fourier transform for a sine will be again in this form, but you'll be having a negative representation for one of the impulses. Okay, because you'll be having, you have to represent cosine in Euler form and then get this result. So there is another one representation, that is the train of impulses. We call it as train of impulses. So when we have a train of impulses, right, which appears as the comb, sometimes we refer it as the comb function or direct delta function. So there are different names under this. So if I just refer it to as the train of impulses, so that is delta t minus n of n into t naught, where t naught is the time duration between each impulse. So here we are starting from minus infinity to infinity, and after every t naught amount of time. So if I start at zero, next impulse is at t naught, next impulse is at plus t naught, next impulse is at plus t naught. If I go in the other direction, the impulse is at minus t naught, minus two times t naught, and so on. So when I consider this one, right, what happens is, if I take the Fourier transform of this, if I take the Fourier transform of this, what I'll be getting is I'll be getting a train of impulses even in the frequency domain. I'll be getting a train of impulses in the frequency domain. And in this case, what happens is this spacing between, that is the frequency spacing between each of the spectrum or each of the impulse will be omega naught. So if I move from this end to the other end, from zero, I'll be having one impulse, next one, at omega naught, I'll be having the next, and so on, I'll be continuing. And in the other direction also, at minus omega naught, minus two omega naught, I'll be having these impulses. But what about the amplitude? Amplitude will be equivalent to omega naught. So you apply it in order to solve this, right? You have to refer to Fourier series and then come to this analysis. Okay. So that is what you have to do in this case. So this is how you will be getting the impulse. So delta t, this thing, delta t naught, t naught is the time period between the impulses. If I consider this, its response will be